Attention bobsled riders! You will soon be embarking on a thrilling podcast down the icy slopes of the Matterhorn. So please remain seated, keeping your hands, arms, feet, and legs inside the bobsled at all times. Auf Wiedersehen!
Hello, Yodlers! We are the Matterhorn Yodlers. I'm your host today, Jackie, and we have...
G-Fifth.
And...
Baloo the Bear!
Baloo's here.
Hey, buddy. Yeah, man. That's what it is.
I love Baloo.
Baloo's good. Today we're going to be talking about the Silver Ages of...
Just age.
Age.
No S. Not like Horizons.
Silver Age movies of Disney animation. So this is movies that were released from 1950 to 1967. This was the movies that came after the wartime era.
All the way to Walt's death.
Yeah, and which basically had a lower budget of movies and fewer workers.
They're all at Disneyland.
Yep. And so the movies that were released, there were 8 of them.
Do you want to name them off so yeah, let us know?
Yeah, I'll let them all know. Peter Pan, Cinderella, Sword in the Stone, Alice in Wonderland, Sleeping Beauty, Lady and the Tramp, 101 Dalmatians. And so we are going to be talking about our favorites. We're going to rank them, what we like them, in what order.
How are we going to do this? So we're going to do like say the movie and then name the rank? Or are we going to start from like number 8 all the way to 1?
Let's go to number 8.
Okay.
Let's
start with 8.
I just want to make sure everybody's on the same page.
Yeah. So, J-Fifth, what was your number 8?
Toy Story 2. number 8 for yes. me? Lady and the Tramp. I don't like animal movies like this. Like pet dogs and cats. It just doesn't do it
my
for
wife
me.
Loves Lady and the
Tramp. And that's the thing, people love it, and it doesn't get me.
It didn't make high on my list.
Yeah. The songs, I think it lacks the songs for me.
Yep.
And what's the villain? The Siamese cats.
Siamese cats. The ones that give us catcher.
The dog catcher. Well, the rat.
The rat. Yeah, the rat.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I remember I had a villain's coloring book, and that literally was the villain for that was the rat.
Yes. Did you put like red demon eyes in there?
Like
what are
they
you
had
doing?
A little game
red eyes
for Lady and the Tramp villain, and it was the rat. But they definitely made, when they did the live action, they made the dog catcher way too obsessive of a villain.
It was kind of neurotic, where it's all like, I guess you're in the best job for you, but I don't know if you should be doing this.
Right. Yeah. This is getting into unhealthy territory.
Yes.
Yeah, actually, let's change it up. So let's just go by movie. So Lady and the Tramp, what place was...
I had that one at 7.
You had 7. Mm-hmm. I had it at 6. So we all had it pretty low.
On the bottom.
On the list.
We don't like dogs. No, I don't lie. We like dogs.
It's like, it's a cute, simple movie, but it's not like a classic go-to watch multiple times.
Do you like Lady?
No.
I think that's what another factor of it.
She's not a likable. Tramp is fun. I like Tramp.
He does bring it up. But it does have that classic scene at the restaurant.
Of course. One of the most iconic moments in cinema history.
We can't watch like a reality TV show like without seeing someone when they're eating spaghetti, like, let's do Lady and the Tramp.
Yeah.
And you're like, let's not, please, because that just looks stupid.
Yeah. You've got...
I'm waiting for the guy in reality TV to take the meatball with his nose and put it onto her plate. That would be more amusing than the spaghetti kiss.
It's true. Well, and it does make the Lady and the Tramp does do decent, because it does have an imprint in the Disney parks. There's Tony's Restaurant.
Which isn't very good.
Tony's Microwave Pasta.
Yeah, it's Olive Garden.
So it's Olive Garden. That's what you know. I mean, Olive Garden's great. You're awesome.
When you're there, we're family.
We're family. Remember that. We don't sue family.
Yeah, Yeah. So it's interesting, like, going through all these movies and seeing, like, their impact today and how they are, like, in the parks and such.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I will go with my number 8.
Okay.
Alice in Wonderland.
Okay.
I rewatched it recently, and, like, before I'm like, oh, Alice in Wonderland's a great movie. When I watch it, it's not great at all.
It's so fragmented.
It makes no sense, which kind of, it's Wonderland. What?
Alice in Wonderland doesn't make any sense?
But, like, what? It's just,
what's up is down and down is up.
It's just a bunch of different clips put together. It's just, like, the wartime shorts. Or movies.
I think it's better than that.
It's better than that.
It is better, but it's not great.
It's lacking direction, and
I would agree.
Walt knew that too. When he watched, he's like, "Oh,
I would agree."
I dropped the ball on this one, guys.
I would agree. It does lack a little bit in the plot story area.
You do have a good villain. You got the Queen of Hearts.
Right,
she's a good villain, I would say. But, like, I kind of wanted more of her.
Like more make, like, her the villain,
more of an intricate part.
It's
of
hard
it.
When you already have a book written, and it's one of those journey,
right?
And so you don't get,
you either follow
you,
the book,
you get a boss,
or you don't.
That's all you get, one boss, and you fight and it's over.
Yeah, so that's my number 8. Where was Alice in Wonderland in your list?
Made 4.
4. Okay,
and I'll tell you why. The music's good.
True.
Music's solid.
It
you
is
got
good.
Unhappy Birthday. You have what is it? Oh my gosh. I'm singing it in my head, but I'm forgetting one.
I like the flower song.
The flower song's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And then you got the How Do You Do and Shake Hands, and the whole Tweedledee Tweedledum song, like the Walrus and the Carpenter.
Painting the Roses Red.
Painting the Rose, like, the music's so good that I couldn't make it that low. So I put it right in the middle, 4 for me.
Come on, beats 101 Dalmatians, Canine Crunchies.
I love Canine Crunchies.
I know you
that's
do.
A great one. That's when, honestly, like, that's when I knew I had crossed into a new line of territory of obsession, was when I realized I had that whole commercial memorized with Canine Crunchies. We'll probably talk about that here in a second.
Yeah, sure.
Where was it for you?
Alice is number 7.
7.
It's just, I don't think I've enjoyed it. Even though I've been the Mad Hatter, mm-hmm. you know, back in the early 2000s, they used to sell the Mad Hatter hat.
Right.
It was nice.
I think it has, the movie has great characters in it, but the story itself
It's definitely a weak story,
it's
but
blah.
It has a lot of great elements besides the story.
And that's why, of course, you see it in the park at Disneyland,
right.
Alice in Wonderland. And, of course, a lot of these attractions are original attractions because it was around when Disneyland was created.
Oh, yeah. Promotion.
Yeah.
Total
promotion. I mean, they're both good. They're great rides. I mean, you can't.
I would rather ride Alice over Peter Pan.
Same.
The ride.
I don't agree.
You don't like Alice in Wonderland, right?
I like Peter Pan over Alice.
Really?
Yes. Nothing beats that flying over London and then you cross over the bridge.
I would agree that the ride itself is cooler, but the amount of, you know, what I have to pay to get onto it, the time
cost
I,
benefit
the cost
ratio
to benefit
is not,
ratio. That's where I'm. Okay. That's where I draw the line. Like, I would agree. Peter Pan is a cooler ride, but in terms of, like, when I get off the ride, I'm not like, oh, I'm glad I waited an hour for that. No.
Said no one. Right. Like, all right, let's ride Snow White. I need to, like, feel like I'm accomplishing getting my money's worth.
Right.
I get it.
That's one attraction I don't care for. I refuse to stand in that line.
I'm with you on that. I'm not over eager to get into it. But when I ride, I'm like, oh, this is it's
right.
It springs me into being a kid.
Yeah.
And when I rode it with my daughter, like, that was really cool to see her, like, light up and see the bedroom and just fly through.
Right.
You know, the fantasy of Peter Pan. That was cool. So, yeah, gotta ride it with a kid.
Yes.
For sure, I think. It's like going trick-or-treating when you're 30. It's not the same.
It's just stealing at that point.
Stealing, or are they freebies at the market?
Right.
What was? Did we go through?
I haven't given my number.
Yeah. Yeah. What is your worst? It's always controversial.
Yeah.
I know. I'm very controversial. Sleeping Beauty.
Mine
was number 7 on it. The only reason.
There's my number 1.
Oh gosh.
Let's get into it now, since we're already low on the list.
It's a snooze fest.
It is.
I would say its redeeming quality is its art. It's beautiful, but I have no desire to watch this movie at all.
I like the songs; they're fun.
And
the one with the drunken like king, that one is hilarious.
It is a funny song. Don't get me wrong.
But... And then the battle, like when they're making the cakes and stuff, I love that scene. And like getting ready for the birthday party, and like. The I wonder, or I know
wonder.
You, yeah. Like
and then
go. That one's fun. I love the catch. And Maleficent is
absolutely.
She's the best villain, and she carries the movie. And for me, and it's the art for it. It that's what carries it to number one. If I'm gonna watch something,
it's
a stimulating,
beautiful
like beautiful
movie.
Story. That's the one.
I just. Like, if I when I was making my list, I went through them all, and I go, which one do I not want to... I grab the ones that I'm like, yeah, I want to watch these. And then I'm like, which one do I not want to watch at all? And Sleeping Beauty was the first one on my mind.
Same. I just... When I rewatch Sleeping Beauty, it's just so boring. It's the movies...
It makes me want to, like, pull my phone out and start doing something else.
And it's just like, she's asleep through half the movie, and it's like, you got the prince.
Yeah.
Does he have a...
Philip.
Philip. He does have a name. Okay.
Charming.
You got Prince Philip, and he's like the star of the show. He's killing Melissa Fay.
Yeah, he's got a great scene.
Yep.
But like, he gets no credit, and that's about it. And
then you have like the dress change at the end.
Blue. Pink.
Make
it blue.
Like,
make it pink.
Fun little like 1 minute segments in the movie that are good, but the rest is not great.
Right.
The only reason why it's not last for me is because of the villain.
Villain's good. I cannot.
I think Maleficent's the best like Disney villain that for me.
I don't know. That might be a discussion for another day, but
best
I don't know if I would classify her as the best villain.
Oh, she just controls like you see the evil just like
and also. Aurora's parents are dumb. They're dumb. They're like, what? In 18 or 16 years, she will prick her finger on one of these? Well, let's hide her away for the next 18 years and bring her on her 18th birthday. What?
And we're going to destroy all commerce when it comes to spindles.
Right. It's just like, they are the dumbest parents ever.
Yeah, the logic did not make any sense. It's like, you could have spent some time with your daughter. You had some time.
Right. So, yeah, that's why I put that one at number 8.
Yeah. Okay. Number 7 for me was Sleeping Beauty. What was your number 7, Peter?
Lady.
What?
Lady and the Tramp.
Lady and the Tramp.
Alice was mine.
Alice in Wonderland.
Okay, so let's move down to 6.
So 6 was Lady and the Tramp for me.
Cinderella.
Okay.
I have Cinderella a little bit higher.
Yeah.
I did 101 Dalmatians. So which one do you want to talk about?
We'll start with 101 Dalmatian. That was number 5 for me.
Okay, so we're around the same area. That 5, 6.
Yeah.
It's another animal movie.
It's like
too many dogs at one point. I get too overwhelmed.
Sure.
It's hard for me to relate. I mean, you're just like, the beginning's great.
Mm-hmm.
I love Roger. I think my wife says me and you are very similar with like Roger and
right.
our personality. And the whole Cruella de Vil singing song.
Oh, love that song.
Yeah.
It's so good.
It's a great song. Cruella's a great villain.
Nah,
she's. I think so. I think she's a good villain to hate on. Like, it's easy to hate her.
Yeah, because she wants to kill puppies.
Right.
Did you like the Cruella film that came out?
Oh, I love that. That was amazing.
That was, I loved how
but
they did that
I
one.
I didn't like how they were trying to, like, make her seem good. And I'm like, no, she's a terrible person.
I didn't get that
she's
feeling.
She's misunderstood, all right?
I didn't get the
she
feeling.
She wants to kill puppies.
No.
Those puppies killed her mom. Fully justified.
The circle is now complete. We understand her motivation now. No.
I will wear my enemy on me.
The whole time watching the movie, I was like, I love the movie, by the way. But the whole time watching the movie, I was like, are they trying to justify why she wants to kill dogs?
No, honestly, like, I kind of took it almost kind of like a Breaking Bad situation. You're watching bad guys do bad things to bad people. So
yeah,
that's how I kind of
as a good person. Self-proclaimed.
Right.
I'm enjoying them destroy each other.
Right. And that's how I kind of took Cruella was this, that movie was just like, because like you look at the things that she did and they were not good things that she did to take down her mom, you know, like,
yeah,
framing her for murder, for her own murder, you know. Yeah. So, like, yeah, there's just a lot of things. Like, yeah, is she a little bit more sympathetic? Sure, but she's still a villain in that movie.
Yeah.
But I actually had, I had that at, I had 101 Dalmatian at 3.
Whoa. Okay, so what? Let's go more into why it's in the middle for you, Jackie.
It's like a meh movie. Like, if it's on, I could probably do dishes while it's on. It's not a let me sit down and watch this. It's kind of a forgettable movie.
I think they have some good, like, side characters, like the geese.
Yeah.
Yep.
Like, my wife and her friend are just like them. They're just laughing all the time around each other. Or I like the two dogs that are chasing. Is that what, or is that, oh, that's Aristocats. Is, yeah, that Aristocats?
Aristocats.
See, I'm all getting them mixed up.
Yeah.
Never
that's,
mind.
That's the next one we're doing.
Yeah. That's next age.
Yeah.
The Bronze Age.
Yes. So what did you like so much about Underworld?
I thought the story was really good. Like, I felt like the plot was good. I enjoyed the villain. Obviously, it has a super iconic song in it. Obviously, I love me some Canine Crunchies.
Canine Crunchies can't be beat. They make each meal a special treat. Happy dogs are those who eat nutritious Canine Crunchies. Canine Crunchies all contain selected meat and wholesome grain. Toy Chihuahua, a Great Dane, all have Canine Crunchies.
That's right. And, you know, I just, there's a couple moments where, like, I get attached to some of the puppies. Like, that their journey is they're like trying to escape Cruella, like when they're going through the snowstorm, and like Lucky's just like, I'm cold, my nose is frozen, and like, you know,
it's
like
a sweet moment.
It's a, like that moment where, like, you know, you see a good father come in and, like,
it's a good example,
saves the day for their kid, and so it's a very relatable moment. You know, it's fun. What's not fun about looking at puppies? I mean, literally. That's what I do all the
time.
There's
just too
anyways.
Many puppies for me. I see it, I'm like, oh, I can't do this.
Oh, don't get me wrong. It's, yeah,
you've got,
it's a
you've
lot
lived
of puppies.
Through many puppies.
I have.
You know, I watched those, like, 20 puppies you had. I was like, I can't. This is so many. Or we had 20 dogs in the house at one time. I was like,
yeah,
so
we
many
did.
Dogs.
We did have, like, 20 dogs in the house.
And
at
I was
point.
Like, let me bring my dog on top of this and, like, let's have fun with this.
Right. Yeah. No. I mean, yeah, it's just, I felt it was good. I felt it was a different artistic take. So they did more of like a watercolor based film.
That's true.
Yeah. So like it was a different art form.
The intro is fun.
Yeah, the intro is great. Like, I thought it was very creative. Like, most times those intros are so boring. You're just like, fast forward. But that one, I'll actually like sit through and watch. Like, even my kids will watch the intro to that. Because you kind of get a, you know, each segment shows off like what they're showing in the credits. So like they've got, you know, the people who splotted all the dots on all the dogs and all of that, you know, and the people who did the backgrounds and the character designs and things like that. So like I thought it was so that I don't know, I get the good feels when I watch it. So that's why it's ranked higher.
Cool. You did a good job describing that. It pushed me to go like, oh, maybe it is better than where it's at.
Okay. Let's see here. Where are we at? I'll just go to my next one then. Jungle Book is number 4 for me.
That's my number 1.
Jungle really? Book's number 5 for me.
Really?
I just, where it is.
I think there are some really great parts. There's like great songs. You got Baloo, like,
you got Sherman Baroness Brothers. You got Sherman Brothers writing music. It's awesome.
It's all good. I think the music is the only thing that I enjoy about it. And so I'm like, I'll just put on the soundtrack. I don't need to watch the movie.
I don't like Mowgli. And I think that's probably why it drives down for me.
Okay.
And it's like, Baloo's great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And like, Bagheera's like a parent.
Yes,
and Bagheera's, it's all like, when I watch the movie, I don't want to be parent.
Bagheera's like the mom, Baloo's like the dad.
Yeah,
and then
and Mowgli's just that defiant kid where you're like, get your stuff together. Yeah. It's the jungle out there,
right?
it's still a good movie. I mean, it's number four for me, and so it's still.
It gets tough in this. It's such good age. There's a lot of good movies here.
I think there's just a lot of great characters. I like the story. Shere Khan is great.
He's a good villain.
You've got a great voice. I forget who did the voice for Shere Khan, but man.
You want to hit that bass note?
That's what friends are for.
Nope.
That's what friends.
Yeah, I'm going to put it in. And for you listeners, I'm gonna put that part in and I'll see if you can hit that note. Because like, I sing bass and I can't hit that note.
I'll throw it out. I think my old roommate Justin Anderson, that guy could laugh and you're like, whoa, what was that? Was somebody have their bass tremble going on right here?
He probably could. Yeah. I'm not gonna lie. He probably could.
No, I love What are the birds called?
The vultures. The vultures.
Vultures.
Yeah,
I love that song.
The Beatles.
Yeah.
The Beatles on wings.
Yeah. I love that.
I quote them all the time. I don't know. What do you want to do?
Actually,
I drive your wife up the wall. It does. It does.
It was good with friends at like high school.
Right. But yeah. Like, I don't know. I think it's fun. It's lighthearted. The music's good. Story is okay.
It's a solid story.
It's a solid story. Like, is it perfect? No, it's not perfect, but I thought it was good.
I always, you know,
King Louis, it's great.
King Louis is great. And when the young girl's getting the water, I always sing like a kind of a parody of like, I must go and get the takeout so my family is fed on my way.
There's a really cool story about that scene in particular, because they were having issues coming up with an ending for the movie,
because this movie goes nothing like the book.
No, because the book is way dark.
Much
very dark.
Man is the villain. Yes, in that story,
right? And so, you know, the Sherman Brothers, they just come up with the idea for this song. You know, I must go to get the water, and then you know they go start talking to one of the head story people, and they say, yeah, we want to show you what we're doing, and they showed him the song, and he goes, guys, I need you to come down to our floor. I need to show you something. And they're literally animating the same thing.
Oh,
they're on the same frequency.
They're on the same frequency with no communication with each other.
I literally have chills.
I had goosebumps too. I was like, oh my gosh, goosebumps.
It's like, whoa, that's like a cool like magic moment. So
that is a good, a good moment right there.
Yeah, I think it's a good solid movie, but it's not like, whoa, amazing. So, my next one is Cinderella. Yours was at the bottom.
Six.
Four for me.
And oh, like, no. I'm sorry. I skipped. But we can talk about Cinderella.
We're here. Let's talk about Cindy.
Cinder is actually
most difficult person to get. No, I don't think most difficult. I think it's the one they screw up the most at Disney.
I think so.
Yeah.
For character
She's
performers.
Very petite.
Yeah. Aurora's tough because she has sharp features. So when I see a good Aurora, I'm like, whoa.
Right.
Hold on to that one. Pay her some more cheese, Mickey.
Cinderella, I actually have two. And because I just think it's classic love story. Everyone quotes it, remakes it.
Oh, yeah. How many Cinderellas have
How many Cinderella movies are there? There's a ton.
I'm not going to lie. I mean, I used, you know, the song to tell my wife I loved her.
That's right. I remember that.
Yeah, we were we were watching Avatar, the blue people Avatar, and we were just decided to dance, and then I started singing.
You just started to dance, like, whoa, these, like, people, like, swinging from trees, like, let's dance. I want to know more about this story. Yeah. Like, you just decided to randomly dance?
Avatar, you're like, let's dance.
We were either watching...
Were you in the movie theater or at home?
We were at my grandma's house.
Ooh, the makeout couch.
Makeout house, yeah. Grandma wasn't living there at the time. No, we were either watching that or we were watching Harry Potter. It was one of those two, because I remember watching those in the house.
I don't know how you just randomly, like, let's dance.
Obviously, they weren't watching the movie.
We never watched any of those movies.
It was one of my tricks, like, tricks. I say tricks. It was one of my moves is, like the fourth or fifth date. I think it was, like, maybe it was third or fourth, I would do like, hey, pick out your favorite movie. So go back to our place. And then it would be a makeout like date right. at that point. So like, yeah, I could see that being the move. I guess it's our move.
Yeah.
Peter dances and I make out.
Yeah.
You know, well, whatever works, you know. But it was just one of those moments. And
you were singing, so you were dancing,
and then I just started singing it to her.
Singing what song?
So this is love. So this is love.
And how did your wife respond?
Oh, she was all in my arms.
I wish she was here. She'd be like, she was like, it was totally weird. I just went along for it.
And the thing is, I don't even know if she's gonna listen to this episode or not, so we'll find out.
There will be no rebuttal.
It was only me and her there, so.
So that's why I like it. It's a classic love story. You've got the mice.
I'll cut it with the scissors. That's made us die laughing.
That's an inside joke with you and your friends.
Oh yeah,
right,
it's totally. It's the best.
The cat. I love
Lucifer.
I love the cat. I think it's a good villain.
And what's the mother called? Madame
Lady Tremaine.
Lady Tremaine. That's right.
Lady Tremaine.
She is evil.
Well, she's voiced by Maleficent.
I know.
So.
I remember watching it. It was like Reese was like, "That's Maleficent."
Yep.
It like hit me really hard. I was like, "Man, I am so slow when it comes to these things."
I think she's more of a relatable villain.
She's the one you don't want to come across in real life.
Yeah.
Like, Maleficent, you were like, I don't know if you're crazy. Until, like, she starts turning people into things. You're like, okay, I've got to be scared of you. But, like, Lady Tremaine's one of those, like, you really don't want as your, like, stepmother or your, like, mother-in-law.
She's manipulative. Big time.
Yeah. Where was Cinderella for you?
It was number four.
Number four.
I would say like Jungle Book and Cinderella go in between. Cinderella's classic and...
You're right. It is a classic, but because it is a classic, I've seen the story so many times. That's why I kind of put it so low, is just because it's a story
overdone.
That's overdone. And I think there are better versions of the story out there.
What version?
Brandy version.
I know your Brandy version.
I'm going to go with the...
You're going to do Rose and the Slipper?
No, not Rose and the Slipper. It's going to be Ever After with Drew Barrymore.
I like the part where Da Vinci's trying to walk on water and he
falls
backward.
It's, it's great.
And they rip off her wings and it's like, you monsters.
Right.
Yeah. It's... I think it is a story. A Jungle Book, I think you guys done a compelling argument where I'd probably flip the two. Jungle Book is unique in itself, and I probably would enjoy myself watching Jungle Book more than Cinderella.
Okay, let's talk about Sword in the Stone. I have that number three.
What? Same here. Yeah.
Two.
It surprised me how far I put it up.
I rewatched it because I was like, well, it's been a while since I watched Sword in the Stone. And I was like, whoa, this is pretty good.
It's fun. Is it a segmented movie? Yes, it is.
Yeah, you could turn it into like a short TV show.
Right.
With how we do things.
It's like,
now.
Okay, this is the bird scene. This is the fish scene. This is,
That barracuda's scary.
Yeah, he is scary.
Every time the barracuda comes out there and the song comes, it's like, ooh, barracuda. Things you watch as adults. Like kids, you're like, never hit my radar. But as adults, like, ooh. I love Archimedes. I think he's that perfect grumpy old character.
He's a great comic relief.
And Madame Mim.
Oh, Madame Mim. It's
underrated.
For sure.
She just made the Villainous game.
Did she?
Yeah. Yep. She just made it into the Villainous game, the board game series. So
I feel like she should have her own movie. Madame Mim movie.
Yeah, it should be about I was about to say, her and Gaston meeting up.
Go back to our second or third episode.
Like our movie mashup I one.
Totally yeah. 2 years ago. It was such a success, we never did it again.
I know, right?
What, you don't want to hear about Captain Hook killing and, Mulan?
Yeah,
that's it. Yeah, that was good. That was a good one.
Peter's story was really good. I was like, I'll watch that. I don't even know what my first one was.
I don't remember. Wasn't it? No, that was like a fight one.
I don't know.
I don't remember what yours was.
Not memorable, apparently.
Good.
It stunk, I guess.
It's not Riverboat Gambling with Walt.
That one I love. I remember I was writing this like, I want to do this. I want to do this so bad. Oh, weekend with Bernie's with Walt, if that's right? The case, doing that.
I like the end of the Sword of Stone where he's all like, I need to get a sword. Oh, let me just grab this one.
Random
and
sword.
And like, why is it singing to me?
I know, the light.
It's like, this is weird. I need the sword.
Imagine you're the guy in heaven that's supposed to sit there and watch this, and you're like, your job is to spotlight on England's next king. Don't forget it. And he's like sitting there forever. He's like, someone, please.
I need another job.
I did something wrong to someone.
Yeah, no, I love the whole, at the very end where he's trying to get away and every door he opens, they're all shouting, Hail King Arthur! Long live the king! And so he's just like blown away by all the people
Merlin,
chanting.
Merlin.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Comes back from vacation.
Oh, he's wearing his Bermuda.
I'm back to Bermuda!
I like Merlin.
He's such a
He's
great
sassy.
Character.
Like, you're not like, you want to like him, but like you get a little frustrated with him at times.
I wish they bring him back to the park at Disneyland.
Yeah, he doesn't make too many appearances.
I'm trying to grow my beard out so I'll be able to be
pull off the roll.
Pull off the roll.
Bring back the Sword of the Stone show.
Well, now the sword will come up.
Yeah, randomly.
Do you have to write a little disclaimer like, yes, I'm touching cancerous material in the state of California?
I think they replaced the sword because it broke.
Somebody yanked it out.
Yeah,
it broke. Actually, leave it to some musclehead to come in and rip it out.
Yeah.
Well, imagine how many wear and tear of people pulling on that thing, and then one day it just pops.
Oh, no, I think some muscle dude just totally blew through it.
Probably.
And I'll probably see the video, and it's like some 40-year-old lady, and Jackie's right where it's like, oh, it broke. She's like, look what I did. I'm king.
But yeah, now it'll kind of randomly come. I think that's only at Disney World. I don't know if that's at Disney.
Yeah, I think it's just Disney World, and I think they just try to do it for kids.
Yeah, I think they have somebody kind of like
they'll
we'll watch
a
it.
Cast member
there'll be
watch
somebody
by.
Watch.
So you gotta look for the fast pass button in the back to lift it up for your kid.
Right. But I always love his, moving song, where he's shrinking everything down into a suitcase. Like, I love that song. Like, that is one song I will listen to 8 different versions of and, sing as loud as I can, too.
I thought there was a lot of comparison to the Sword and Stone and Cinderella story.
How so? I'm
curious.
With,
the two, Cinderella and Arthur.
Okay.
You know, they're doing the chores, they have lots of responsibility, but they are greater for Destins. They've got two magical, kind of... Fairy godmother, you got Merlin.
Sure.
Teaching them, showing their potential.
I wish there was a witch battle, with the fairy godmother.
Oh, yeah. With the
Cinderella
3.
You kind of get that, where the wand comes in. That was... They did a good job with that.
Right.
And then, they get into, their royalty. They end up in a castle and whatnot to a greater responsibility. I don't know. There's a lot of similarity, I thought, between those two.
You bring up good points. I never thought of it
that
way.
No, it's a valid. Sword in the Stone is the boy version of Cinderella.
Yeah.
Just no glass slippers.
That's it.
There's just swords. There's no just romance. Swords.
There's no romance. That's well, why... those squirrels.
Yeah.
That's... Madam, I'm a man. The best.
And the squirrels like, yeah, you are.
That was, I love that. My wife will like start like flirting with her, like, Madam. Madam. I'm a married man.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think that's why, yes, I saw the similarity between Cinderella and Sword of the Stone, but I did put Cinderella on top just because I enjoyed the love story more.
Sure. Understandable.
I enjoy the squirrel love story much better and relate to it better. The rejection is so much more real than that one.
And you feel really bad for that girl squirrel.
Oh, yeah.
How she's so sad that he... That,
that is so true. Like, that is...
That's an emotional
moment. You feel that emotion.
Go back to Disney movies that make us cry. Let's talk about the squirrel
rejection.
Hey, and it's like him trying to make her feel better when he turns human again.
That's honest.
I'm not trying to hurt you. Like, I was like,
the guys always transform into a monster,
right?
Okay, I think we only have one movie left, and that's Peter Pan.
Yeah, it was number 2 for me.
Number 1.
I would have thought you would have had that one lower.
What was your number 1?
Sleeping Beauty.
Oh, that's right.
I like the art better.
Peter Pan was my number 1.
I had it right in the middle, 5.
I was just always a Peter Pan fan as a kid.
It's adventure.
Yeah, it's a good adventure story.
Like, the Lost Boys, you got Captain Hook, you got Peter Pan, and... Poor Nana.
Oh, that's scene. Nana. There was another moment where I realized the dad's voice, Captain Hook's.
Yep.
I was an adult. I was like, that's Captain Hook. And I was man, I am so slow at this.
I knew that one as a child.
All right. Part of me make me feel bad. All right.
part of me thought that it was like that Captain Hook was supposed to represent the father.
Yeah.
You know, that was the whole.
Supposed to grow up.
Right. So I kind of figured that one out. A little slow there.
I am very slow when it comes to like literary and movie analysis. I'm good at figuring out who did it in a murder. I get that from Mother Yodler.
Yes. Yeah.
You watch something, it's like, oh, they did it. And it's like, and that's the murder weapon. They showed it for 2 seconds too long.
Right, they focused on something.
Yeah, I just think overall, Peter Pan has it all. It's got the good story. It's got the good characters.
I don't think Peter Pan's a very likable character.
Oh, he's a horrible turd. I watched as an adult, and I'm like, he is not likable.
He's not a good character.
And that's why you need to grow up, because you turn into
Peter Pan,
and it's not a good thing. Mm-hmm. And I think they did a good job in portraying, like, time to grow up, boys.
Okay. So, are there some songs in that that are inappropriate now?
Yes. Oh, boy.
Oh, yeah. Yes, there is.
Oh, boy. The whole movie is a discovery. I wish they did it for each scene. You're like, okay, this scene specifically is what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Not the Yo-Ho song, this song.
I kind of make the argument that Peter Pan's worse than Song of the South. So.
I haven't seen Song of the South. You guys have seen it?
Yes.
I have not, so I can't make that argument, but it's pretty bad.
Yeah.
I've been watching all of the Disney movies.
Disney racist movies? No. What are the top 5 for Jackie?
That's going to be episode for another day. Top 5 racist movies.
Oh, no.
Let's not get into that.
So I've been watching... So if you go on Disney Plus, you go to the movie section.
Was there a racist section? Which ones have disclaimers? Because those are the best.
Pinocchio, Dumbo, Peter Pan.
Stop.
I'm trying to remember. I think Cruella does. I mean, 100.
Oh, that's under the animal abuse tab.
Yeah.
So I've been going through all the movies alphabetically, watching all the movies alphabetically on Disney Plus, and, you know, on the movies that have racism in them, they'll have, like, a warning, a caution.
Why is it the smallest print on the screen? Couldn't you really, like, it's like they're shame, they're like in the corner, and they're like, yeah, we did something bad, and... Now you have to read this.
Do you really want it out there, like in big bullets? This movie's racist.
And you know what? It would save me a lot of time and going like, all right, cool. Like, I just need to be mentally prepared. Like, judged on the values of their level at their time, you know? Like,
right.
Not appropriate now.
Yeah, so we were watching this movie. It was like the California Gold Rush kind of movie or whatnot. And we're going through and we're like, okay, it seems fine. And
oh, are you talking about Bullwhip Griffin?
Yeah.
Oh, I love Bullwhip Griffin. Yeah, so that's such a fun movie.
Watching it, we're like, okay, this is fine. Nothing's crazy. And then, like, you see the racism scene, and my husband goes, there's the racism.
Yeah. It almost turns into, like, a hidden Mickey now.
It has turned into
it. Oh, it's got this.
With these old movies, that's what it is now. It's just, like, Easter eggs of, like, oh, what's not appropriate now?
Yeah. That does turn that into a game. So... But I think Peter Pan's great. Good music. I know it's always going to be fun when I watch it. Watching it as an adult, yeah, I analyze the characters. And I always kind of thought was like, maybe Captain Hook was a lost boy and that he's just trying to get his revenge. Like, what did I hear that? Was that from you? It was like, I had heard that where Peter, like Captain Hook was a lost boy and that Peter Pan kills the lost boys when they get too old. And... the pirates were lost boys that Captain Hook has saved, and they're all trying to exact their revenge on Peter Pan.
I'm trying to remember what the storyline for Once Upon a Time was.
It's
I know,
not, yeah, so Once Upon a Time was great because Peter Pan's the villain, and that actor who played Peter Pan on Once Upon a Time,
ooh,
it was great. It's probably the best season of Once Upon a Time.
Not the one where, like, I guess we're going to Hades, and that's like, I guess I'm not watching this show again. Like, I don't know what happened.
I don't know.
I
think Frozen, when Frozen came into play, I was kind of like, meh, okay.
Yeah.
It was Dark Swan. Dark Swan was interesting. I was like, ooh, edgy. And then they're like, let's go to Hades. I was like, let's not. I'm done.
Yeah. But Peter Pan's an interesting character.
Best season Once Upon a Time. Without actually watching all of them.
You think they're going to make a live action Peter Pan?
Yeah, probably. Why not?
Is there money in people's pockets that Disney wants?
Yeah.
They did Lion King. They've done all these other movies, and it's just like...
It's live action, a.k.a.
CGI. I hate that.
It's so annoying.
I mean, we got Pinocchio. When this episode comes up, Pinocchio will be out. I'm actually excited for that one. That one actually
is it Tom Hanks?
It's Tom Hanks.
So you hope it's good.
You would hope that Tom Hanks would approve of a script before he's...
I don't know. I think he's in the Robert De Niro and Morgan Freeman where he's all like, how
I'll
much money? Or the Harrison Ford like, I'll talk to an imaginary dog. For $20 million.
I'll pet a man who you'll turn into a dog, yes.
I worked next to a Wookiee for years. Why not? Like, it's totally same. I love you, Harrison. I'm not trying to dog you.
Yeah.
So we're right there. What were our number ones? I had Sleeping Beauty.
Peter Pan.
Jungle Book.
All right. So we're all three different.
All different.
Some grouped together, and then some are different.
Yeah, so let us know
where yours ranked.
Yeah, where?
What's
where
your number one?
Ranking? Yeah, we want to know what your number one.
Tell
pick
us
is.
How Lady and the Tramp is your number one. My wife would probably make that argument.
I think she could make a good
argument.
Yeah,
she probably could. She loves that movie, but she might make a better argument for 101 Dalmatians. She would probably go lean more that direction than Lady and the Tramp.
I can see that.
Yeah,
definitely.
You can let us know through our Facebook, our Instagram. You can email us. And we can read it off if you like. You can send us a voice message on Anchor. You can notify us on Twitter and everywhere. So spread the word about the podcast. We've got new sound.
I know.
Let us know what your thoughts are on our sound. Do you like it? Do you want us to go back?
I hope you like it.
There was money invested into
this. Money was invested in this. Lie to me, please. Does this dress make me look fat? Yeah, it sounds great.
But that's all the time we have. Have a magical day.
Thank you for joining us on this week's episode of the Matterhorn Yodelers. Please remember, before your bobsled comes to a complete stop, to follow us on Facebook and Instagram. And remember...
Remain seated, please. Permanecer sentados, por favor.